Ladies and gentlemen, of late, Indian Museum has started a series of lectures on stories of world culture. I am happy to be associated with it. To introduce myself, I am Professor Kishore Kumar Basa. I was director, Indian Museum, Kolkata, Indira Gandhi Rashtriya Manav Sangrahalaya, Bhopal, and Anthropological Survey of India. I was a professor in the Department of Anthropology, Utkal University. Today, I'll be speaking on history of ethnological collections in Indian Museum during colonial period. This is a broad outline of my lecture. First, I will discuss certain interrelated terms, ethnography, ethnology, and anthropology very briefly. It is believed that Indian Museum was a repository of ethnological specimens. I'll be discussing this history of ethnological collections in two phases. Phase one from 1814 to 1865, and phase two from 1866 to 1940s. There are two criteria in determining these two phases. To begin with, Indian Museum was a part of Asiatic Society of Bengal. Subsequently, by the Indian Museum Act of 1866, it became an imperial museum, and the authority for managing the museum was transferred from Asiatic Society to a board of trustees. Besides, during the second part of 19th century, there was the emergence of distinct scientific disciplines as distinct entities. For example, geology, archaeology, zoology, so on and so forth. Towards the end, I'll be discussing the importance and implications of these collections. Ethnography is a study of particular culture or community for understanding that particular culture on the basis of fieldwork. Ethnology is a comparative study of cultures. And also, there is an attempt to build up theories for understanding cultures. It is believed that ethnography provides the raw data for the development of theoretical framework in ethnology. Both ethnography and ethnology are part of cultural anthropology. Anthropology may be defined as a biocultural study of humankind in time and space. When the Britishers came to rule over India, they rightly perceived that in order to rule India effectively, they must understand the cultural background of the natives, both belonging to the past culture as well as the contemporary culture. Therefore, archaeology developed as a subject to understand the past cultures, and ethnography and ethnology developed as a means of understanding the contemporary native cultures. Indian Museum is regarded as an encyclopedic museum for two reasons, because first of all, its collection is very large, and secondly, it is very diverse. It ranges from artifacts of archaeology belonging to Harappan civilization and Egyptian civilization on the one hand, to geological, paleontological, botanical, and zoological remains, as well as specimens belonging to art and ethnology. The museum came up in 1814 because Nathanael Wallich, a Danish prisoner of war, wrote to Secretary of Asiatic Society of Bengal, H.H. Wilson, a letter dated 2nd February 1814, emphasizing the need for the establishment of a museum. And the Asiatic Society readily agreed, and therefore the museum came up in 1814. But prior to that, there was a feeling as early as 1790s for the need of a museum, because when John Shore was the Governor General, there was this feeling for the establishment of a museum in India. Indian Museum is regarded as a repository of ethnological specimens. But before I do that, the ethnographic and ethnological studies during colonial period has resulted in the development of certain colonial stereotypes. For example, the terms such as noble savage, criminal tribes, martial race are typical colonial stereotypes which have had emerged during the colonial period as a result of their ethnographic studies. As far as the phase one collection is concerned, this is, as I said, from 1814 to 1865. The central constitutive art during this early phase was collecting and not of display. In 1814, we find in the Asiatic Society of Bengal, there is a list of 16 collecting areas, which include almost all branches of sciences, but out of which the four related to ethnology. These include instruments of war peculiar to the East, instruments of music, vessels used in religious ceremonies, implements of native art and manufacture. In 1814, J. Brown presented a set of sidearms belonging to the inhabitants of Nepal, consisting of one cutlass, a knife, a still, and flint for striking fire in a leathern case. The artist Robert Home gave a brass standish and pen case. Sir Stamford Raffles provided a set of Javanese knives and daggers. In 1816, 174 items were donated by 27 European donors. And these donors included Colonel Stuart, Dr. Tytler, General Mackenzie, Brian Hodgson, etc. During 1819 and 1822, Margaret Tytler gave three types of artifacts to Indian Museum. She was the daughter of H.W. Tytler, and she was living with her brother in Champaran in Bihar. And these three types of artifacts included 75 wooden models executed with the help of Indian carpenters for the museum. And the second category involved 50 duplicate models from our own collection in 1819 with full descriptions, and added many more by 1821. This included apparatus used to weave cotton rugs or shatranjis, a turner's lathe, machinery for raising water, weaving, spinning, and machinery for distillation of spirituous liquor and rose water. The third category included architectural models of a mosque, a granary, a cart drawn by oxen, and a temple from Nepal, which were sent to the society before her death. This is an example of a model of bullock cart. These are some of the examples of early collections. For example, this is a Kareva belonging to the Nicobarese, and this dates back to 1830. We do not know who was the collector. Similarly, we do not know who collected this horse with a rider made of brass brought from Chhattisgarh, again dated to 1830. Gradually, Indians became interested in giving gifts to the museum. For example, in 1832, out of 49 donors, 6 were Indians, and they included Ram Kamal Sen, Kali Kishan Bahadur, Maharaja Radhakanta Dev, Mathurnath Mallik, Sivachandra Das, and Her Highness Begum Samru. Ram Kamal Sen, who was the Diwan of Bengal Bank and the first Indian Secretary of the Asiatic Society, was one of the earliest Indian donors to the Indian Museum during 1830s. And his donation also had great ethnographic interest, because it included implements used in the Charak ceremony, material used by Vairagis, ornaments worn by women in Orissa, 3 small Buddha images, 51 musical instruments. This is a Kalawas vessel used by American Indian in New Guinea. And this is a collection which dates back to 1850. We do not know who was the collector. Again, this is an early collection dated to 1850, female dress of a Khasi, belonging to the Khasi and Jointia Hills. Again, we do not know who was the collector. Similar is the case with a Naga cloth from Naga Hills, dated to 1850. Now let us discuss the collections in the phase two, which is dated between 1866 to 1940s. The Indian Museum Act was enacted in 1866. So now the museum no longer belonged to the Asiatic Society. Now it was to be run by a board of trustees. John Anderson became curator and then superintendent. He took active interest in ethnological specimens. And from 1866, there was continuous addition to ethnological collection, which are reported in the annual reports of the museum. And these objects included from the Andamans, such as a dancing board, food dishes, a landing net, and a fish basket, bottles and flints, also Naga spears and bows, a bhutia, trumpet and leaf sandals, famine foods, a model of a Ceylon canoe, garo clothes, ornaments and arms from Chittagong, Cox's Bazar, Nagpur, Bardhaman, North Arakan, and Midnapur Santals. Musical instrument collection of the Asiatic Society Museum was also a very interesting collection, which ultimately was transferred to the Indian Museum. And these included wind, stringed, and percussion instruments. And these were collected from different parts of Bengal. And the musical, there are also musical instruments from China and the Arakans. For the London exhibition of 1874, musical instruments were collected from eminent families in Calcutta. And they were subsequently sent to that exhibition. These musical instruments were donated to the museum by Raja Jyotindra Mohan Tagore, Surendra Mohan Tagore, and Maharani Swarnamaya in 1875 to commemorate the visit of the Prince of Wales in that year. Although the Asiatic Society formally transferred its ethnological specimens to the Indian Museum in 1875, it took almost two decades to make the ethnological gallery ready for the public in January 1893. So this is an example of a Moiru Bina donated by Surendra Mohan Tagore. This is the Mahakachapi Bina. Besides that, the commissioner and deputy commissioner of Assam also presented ethnological collections to Indian Museum. For example, the deputy commissioner of Assam presented this cart of Jelian Naga in 1876. The chief commissioner of Assam presented a cotton cloth of Angami Naga. The chief commissioner of Assam again donated a Mao Naga skirt in 1876. E.H. Mann was one of the early colonial ethnographers who made an expedition to Andaman and Nicobar. And from there, not only he documented the collection well, but also he sent the specimen to almost all leading museums of Europe. E.H. Mann also presented some collection to the Indian Museum. For example, this is a West Girdle used by the Andamanese, and it dates back to 1877. This is another item given by E.H. Mann, a feather brass used by Andamanese, again dates back to 1877. The Rab West belt made of bark fibers was used by the Andamanese. This was again gifted by E.H. Mann to Indian Museum in 1877. The Great Calcutta Exhibition of 1883-84 was a very important occasion for the history of ethnological collection, because for that exhibition, models of tribal communities classified into racial types were prepared under the supervision of Herbert Hope Risley. After the Great Exhibition in 1885-86, the ethnological collections were made over to the newly appointed officer in charge of Bengal Economic Museum. The combined economic, ethnological, art, and industrial collections belonging to the government of Bengal was handed over to the trustees of the Indian Museum on 1st April 1887. It was Mr. Atkinson who was a chairman board of trustees Indian Museum, who presented a solar belt belonging to the Wanchos to the Indian Museum in 1890. It is interesting to note that the Reporters of Economic Product also had undertaken a tour in 1898 to the Northeast India and Burma, and they collected a large number of samples of cloth from their tour. This is known as the textile collection from REP tours. So these are the such examples. A mekhali of Garo women from Gwalpada in Assam. It was given to the Indian Museum in 1898. Another example was a kuki cloth from North Kachar. Another example is a dhubri used by the Misni, given by the Reporter of Economic Products in their tour of Northeast. It is important to mention that Viceroy Lord Curzon, who had tremendous contribution to the collection of Indian Museum. He has marked interest in Indian Museum, and there are three aspects. First, he was making gifts of objects to Indian Museum. Second, he arranged an annual grant of ₹6,000 for the purchase of specimen of Indian art. He used to visit Indian Museum and even was taking interest in the display of a throne of Theba, King of Burma, during 1878 to 1885, which was presented by Lord Curzon to Indian Museum. In the annual report of 1901-2, 433 ethnological specimens were presented by Lord Curzon, which were displayed in two bays. These were from various areas like Kachin Hills, Pangmi, Tezpur, and various areas of northeastern India and Burma. In the annual report of 1902-3, it is stated that 14 specimens of art were donated by Viceroy Lord Curzon to Indian Museum. These include the throne of Theba, one model of a Nepalese temple, four ivory and wooden chauris from Bharatpur state, and ivories from Dhaka. In 1903-4, he donated a model of a boat carved in ivory to the art section of Indian Museum. Now, this is the model of a boat in ivory from Murshidabad, which was donated to Indian Museum in 1904 by Lord Curzon. This is the effigy of a Tongyo woman of Southern Sun States from Burma. It is made of wood. It was donated by Lord Curzon in 1902. This is a cloth from Kachin, Burma, again donated by Curzon in 1902. This is a wrist waist girdle of Angami Naga, presented by Lord Curzon in 1902. Besides, there are other ethnological specimens. 36 ethnological specimens were reported or received in 1902-3. The collection included an interesting series of plows as used in the different districts of Bengal, presented by Mr. B. Hutton, officiating principal, Civil Engineering College, Sipur. In 1903, duplicate specimens from the Lhasa expedition were donated to the Indian Museum. In 1903-4, New Zealand chief's sword of solid whalebone was bequeathed to the Indian Museum by Mr. W. B. Colville of Calcutta. Sir Herbert Risley in 1904 suggested that the ethnological collection be transferred to zoology section, and this received the legislative sanction in Indian Museum Act 1910. The transfer of ethnological collection to the zoology section was implemented in 1911. There were fresh attempts made for ethnological collection and gallery. During 1911-12, S.W. Kemp, a naturalist in the zoology section, collected specimens from the Abor or the Adi community while participating in a military expedition in the Nepha region, which is presently Arunachal Pradesh. During 1914, Sir Surendra Mohan Tagore donated the complete set of musical instruments that were played by the orchestra he had arranged in 1875 during the visit of Prince of Wales. He also donated a set of Japanese instruments that were presented to him by the Emperor of Japan to celebrate the centenary of the museum and affirm his loyalty to the crown. This is an example of a large drum and sticks from Japan, donated by Rajasri Sir Surendra Mohan Tagore to Indian Museum. The Geological Survey of India came in 1916, and Geological and Ethnological Sections was entrusted to N. Anandel. Anandel was taking a lot of interest in anthropology, and there are important aspects from the anthropological point of view. Firstly, with his experience of anthropological fieldwork in Faroe Islands and Malay Peninsula, he introduced systematic fieldwork for collection of specimens and took positive steps for utilizing anthropological specimens for study purposes. Secondly, he set up a physical anthropology laboratory in Indian Museum for the first time in India. Thirdly, he carried out anthropometric measurements of the Anglo-Indians of Calcutta with critical observations on their physical features. All his data was passed on to P.C. Mahalanobis for statistical analysis. Anandel paid a visit to Northeast, particularly Manipur, and collected not only textile, but other ethnological collections. This is a cloth, Manipuri cloth from Manipur by Anandel. J.H. Hutton, another well-known ethnographer and ethnologist, made contribution to the collection of Indian Museum. For example, he donated a skirt of Kacha Naga from Naga Hills in 1927. Again in 1927, Hutton gave a textile belonging to the Rengama Naga from Naga Hills to Indian Museum. He also presented a waist cloth belonging to the Angami Naga from the Naga Hills in 1929 to Indian Museum. R.B. Seymour took over Geological Survey of India in 1926, and he felt the need for an anthropologist for ethnological collection. And accordingly, B.S. Guha was appointed in 1927 to the Geological Section. For the first time, the ethnological collection of the Indian Museum came directly under a professional anthropologist. There are a number of important aspects of B.S. Guha. Firstly, Guha was trained both in anthropology and museum in Harvard University by R.B. Dixon in Primitive Arts and Industries. He was also a graduate assistant in the Peabody Museum of Harvard University. Secondly, like the tradition in the United States, he worked on the museum collection and undertook fieldwork, especially on the NEFA, present Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland, Andaman Islands, etc. Thirdly, he studied Indian population, both past and present. He made the racial classification on the present Indian population. He initiated studies on skulls excavated from the undivided Indian archaeological sites of Mohenjo-daro, Harappa, Takshashila, and some megalithic sites of South India. He also prepared a report on human relics recovered from the Naga Hills in the expedition for the abolition of human sacrifice during 1926-27. He had also undertaken a scientific expedition in 1928. Besides, he was also associated with the Census of India conducted in 1931. Therefore, one could say that there was all-round development of anthropology under B.S. Guha. The anthropology section of Indian Museum, which was attached to the Geological Section of Indian Museum, became a nucleus in the setting up of the Department of Anthropology, which became subsequently known as Anthropological Survey of India way back in 1946. Now, besides Guha, S.S. Sarkar made collection from Maler and Santal Parganas in 1938. This is an effigy of a Khalas. From Kafiristan in Hindu Kush of modern Pakistan in 1929, belonging to the Khalas community. Margaret Millward also made an interesting contribution to the collection of ethnological collection of Indian Museum. She was basically a sculptor. She returned to India in 1935 to undertake a journey with an anthropological perspective. She was known to Verrier Alwyn as well and interacted with him. She completed 100 heads of Indian racial types. A complete set of Millward's sculptures was donated by her to the Museum of Anthropology and Archaeology in the University of Cambridge in 1947. However, several of our bronze cast heads of Indian tribes are in the museum, which are purchased by B.S. Guha. These are the examples of some bronze cast heads of Indian tribes prepared by Margaret Millward and which are in Indian Museum Ethnological Collection. Now let me speak on the importance and implications of collections. Now, the various objects collected from different parts of the world showed the extent of British Empire and also beyond. These objects also demonstrated the creativity in art and craft traditions of India. These also showed the cultural diversity of India. In the initial phase, collection was the central constitutive force because during that time, disciplines were also yet to emerge. One could say that history of Indian Museum and the emergence of different scientific disciplines almost coincide in India. For example, Geological Survey of India was set up in 1851. Archaeological Survey of India came up in 1861. Botanical Survey of India in 1890. Geological Survey of India in 1916, and Anthropological Survey of India in 1946. Indian Museum became the repository of specimens of all these surveys for all their collections. And therefore, one could say that Indian Museum witnessed the emergence of modern science in India. Usually, a critique is made against museum that objects are decontextualized from its original context when they are brought to the museum. There is some element of truth. But one could say that when these decontextualized objects were put on display, there is an invention of another context. And when such objects were put on display, they bring out a wider perspective to that object and it's showing its interrelationship with other objects and other cultures. Besides, objects imply the dissemination of European system of knowledge, and in that sense, they provide a means of imparting scientific, objective, rational, modern knowledge to the visitors. But however, there was a rupture, because we know that people from rural parts of India visit Indian Museum right from the colonial period, even until now. And when they come to Calcutta, they first take bath in the Ganga. They also visit other places, and along with Indian Museum. So museum visit as a part of pilgrimage is a typical Indian response to a Western metropolitan concept called museum. In that sense, the application of a Western metropolitan concept called museum is not a passive process, rather a creative engagement between the museum objects and the native visitors. Because for most of the native visitors, museum was a wonder house, a place of strange objects. The Bharat Gallery in Indian Museum shows the archaeological splendor, implying that India's past was full of grandeur, but our colonial present was characterized by squalor. Models of tribal groups showing different races in Indian 1883-84 Great Calcutta Exhibition, which later became part of Anthropological Collection of Indian Museum, showed that the natives, along with their objects in the museum, represented an inferior status than the colonial rulers in an evolutionary scale. Therefore, India needed the civilizing mission of the British rule to learn and experience modernity. Hence, the colonial ethnological collections in Indian Museum do not represent a silent and innocent manifestation. On the contrary, they have an eloquent implication in providing legitimacy to the British colonial rule in India. I convey my sincere thanks to you, ladies and gentlemen, for your patient hearing. I sincerely hope that you will be interested in witnessing the vast and collection of ethnological collections in Indian Museum during your next visit. Thank you.